So I was thinking on my way walking over here from my office, which is just a couple blocks, a long, long time ago when I first started this job, talking about schizophrenia was kind of a depressing thing, I think, because we really didn't have a lot of great answers for the schizophrenic patients, and working with people with schizophrenia often seemed pretty discouraging. And I think, you know, looking back to when I first started doing this, things have improved an awful lot. We have a lot more, we have a lot of new drugs on the market these days. The country seems to be becoming more and more aware of what an important concern this illness is, and is pumping more and more money into research, so things feel a lot more optimistic. Certainly, the patients that I see these days, especially the young people who are starting out with relatively new medications, for the most part, do a lot better than they did a long time ago when I was first starting this job. So it's a bit more fun for me to do this talk tonight, because I think there's lots of happy parts to talking about schizophrenia. So I'm going to talk about a little bit about schizophrenia spectrum disorders. Then we're going to talk about, then we'll take some time, maybe the majority of the evening, and talk about schizophrenia. Then I'll briefly go through some other kind of not so clearly related psychotic illnesses. And then maybe we'll talk a little bit about medication. So this, as we always do in these presentations, we're taking the diagnostic criteria for schizophrenia out of the latest diagnostic manuals that that we use in the world of mental health. So these are the fundamental or basic criteria for making a diagnosis of schizophrenia that are, these criteria are used in North America. And in actual fact, although in Europe they have their own diagnostic manual, for the most part these days they're using the American-produced diagnostic criteria. So these are the criteria, some of the words you probably won't recognize, and I'm going to explain what some of these terms and phrases are as we move along. So just to give you an overview of what we're going to be talking about tonight, this illness is an illness in which people are diagnosed if they have two or more of these symptoms going on for at least a month at some time in the course of their illness. So then this, people need to have a couple of combinations of delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, changes in motor behavior, and some negative symptoms. So we'll explain that in a minute. And as well, it's very important that for a significant portion of time since the beginning of the illness, there's a change in the level of functioning in one or more major areas of people's lives. So what that means is that in order to make a diagnosis of this illness, people must have the symptoms that are required, but also for a period of time during their illness, we must see some impairment in their ability to function socially and their ability to function occupationally or academically or to look after themselves. So there has to be evidence of impairment, and the illness must go on for at least 6 months. So we'll see in the next few slides as we go through a few of the schizophrenia spectrum disorders that the next few illnesses that I'm going to show you slides on now are pretty similar to this, but the duration is the difference we're going to be talking about is the length of time that these illnesses go on for. So we'll show you that quickly here. So there is a condition in our manual called a brief psychotic disorder, and we really do see quite a bit of this. I would guess in our hospital ward we end up having maybe 10 or 12 people a year that end up with a brief psychotic disorder. A brief psychotic disorder has most of the symptoms of a schizophrenic illness, but doesn't have the negative symptoms attached. And the main thing to notice here is a brief psychotic illness has a duration of less than a month. Typically when we see this, it happens very rapidly. It doesn't sort of evolve over a period of months or years, but it happens almost overnight. And we see quite a bit of it. I was thinking tonight, probably I can think of four or five people who have been in and out of our hospital that I looked after in the last 6 months that had a brief psychotic illness. So often these are people under enormous stress. And then over a rapidly evolving period of time, they come into hospital or hallucinated or deluded, not sleeping, very agitated, and really quite ill. And then things resolve very quickly, often in the course of a week or less, sometimes in the course of a day or two, but always within a month. So this can be a very serious looking illness when people come into the hospital with this illness and it's gone in a month, and then that's usually the end of the treatment. The trick, I think, is if somebody comes into hospital, which happens with this illness quite commonly, people come in, they seem very ill in the emergency room, we admit them, we have no idea if this is going to last for a month or for 7 years. So we treat them quite aggressively, and then in a week they're all better, and then you're wondering, if I hadn't treated them, would they have got better? So are they better because of the medication and the treatment, or are they better because they have a very short-lived illness? So if you get somebody all better in 3 weeks and then they go home, you find yourself wondering in 6 months, do they really still need to be on medication? Was their illness destined to go away anyhow? So there's a bit of a trick in that. And it's always kind of a happy news story when somebody comes in and just can be very ill and in a very short period of time is much better and then never get sick again. So this is a brief psychotic disorder. Then moving it along a little bit, you can see that we have something called schizophreniform disorder. And the big thing here is the duration. So in schizophreniform disorder, the symptoms are pretty much the same as schizophrenia. The negative symptoms are included. We have delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, changes in motor behavior, and negative symptoms. You need to have two of these. Often people have more than two, but you need to have two. And it has to go on for up to 6 months. So then when we move on to the so you can see then the difference, just to sum up the duration. Schizophrenia is a minimum of 6 months. The brief psychotic disorder lasts up to a month. Schizophreniform disorder is kind of bridges the two, lasts anywhere from a month to about 6 months. And then once you hit the 6 month mark, people end up having a diagnosis of schizophrenia. So the majority of people who have schizophreniform disorder that come in having delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, and these symptoms, who are still ill at 5 months, will almost certainly progress to develop schizophrenia. Some people, the majority of people who get a diagnosis of schizophreniform disorder where they're still ill after a month, the majority of them will end up having schizophrenia. Some of them will end up being asymptomatic and their illness will come to an end in less than 6 months, but more than half of them progress to a schizophrenic illness. So this slide is a repeat just to remind you of the diagnostic criteria for what we're about to talk about in a bit more detail. So we're going to talk about schizophrenia, and again, in order to make this diagnosis, you must have two or more of these symptoms, and each one must go on for pretty much a month, a significant portion of a month. Some people say it has to be a month. So these things we'll explain in a little more detail. There has to be some impairment in function in some aspect of your life, and it has to go on for 6 months. So that's kind of the nuts and bolts of how we diagnose schizophrenia. There's a few more criteria that I didn't add because it just gets more and more complicated, sort of ruling out other possible conditions like brain tumors and things like that, drugs. But we'll talk a little more about those things as we go on also. So this is the basics of how we diagnose schizophrenia. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the key or the major features that we see in this illness, try and explain a little bit what some of these fancy words and names mean, and try and give you a better impression of what this illness looks like. So I think before I start that, you know, it's really important for people to realize that this illness is what is referred to as being extremely heterogeneous, which means that, you know, people with this illness, some people, as you can see from the diagnostic criteria, some people come in and predominantly have hallucinations. So maybe they're hearing a bunch of voices, they don't have any delusions, maybe they have some changes in motor behavior, and then you have somebody else who has a whole lot of negative symptoms and doesn't have any voices. So when you start to think about it, different people with this illness can look very differently, and their prognosis can be enormously different. So as I go through this presentation tonight, I'm not going to stop every 5 minutes and remind you that, you know, we're talking about, you know, all of the, we're giving you an overview of how we make the diagnosis. And if you're not careful, you'll end up thinking that everybody with this illness has everything that I'm talking about. And it's not true, because there's a huge variety in the symptom clusters that people get. There's a huge variety in prognosis, huge variety in lots of things. So it's a real smattering of people with different looking clinical conditions. So it's important to know that. So we're going to do a few definitional things. So delusions are really fixed beliefs that people have. They're beliefs that people hold with great tenacity that can't be changed by evidence. So probably the most common delusion that people hear about are people that are paranoid. So if you have delusions of paranoia and you believe that the mafia is out to get you, and I come and I talk to you about that and you say, I know they're out to get me, and I ask you, you know, how do you know that, and are you really sure that they're coming to get you? If people say to me, well, I'm not really sure, but I'm pretty sure, and I think that probably this is happening, then it doesn't qualify to be a delusion. A delusion must be a very fixed belief that can't be altered by somebody else giving you information that they think might prove that your thinking is wrong. So it's important to kind of know that for families, perhaps, and for people that are treating this illness, that if you have a delusion, then people trying to talk you out of it is an absolute and complete waste of time. You're just going to end up with people being annoyed and irritated with you. And if you think that people are out to get you, but you're not really sure that they are, then it's not a delusion. And where it gets a bit confusing is sometimes when people come into the hospital or come into my office and they're quite delusional, as they get better, their delusions kind of soften and then they start to wonder if that was really real or not. So they might go through a phase of their illness where they're having these things that are delusion-like but not quite held with that level of tenacity, but it's a progression in the illness. So it's not that you still have to say when you're delusional, you can't be talked out of it, you can't be persuaded that this isn't true. But of course, as people get better, the things soften. So I've given you some examples, common examples of the types of delusions we see. Most of them will be fairly familiar to people. Paranoid delusions or persecutory delusions are what we just talked about, the belief that someone is going to be harmed or harassed by another individual or perhaps an organization or a group. It's probably the most common kind of delusion. It is the most common kind of delusion that we would see in schizophrenia. Schizophrenic people, when they're very ill, very commonly believe that somebody's out to get them. And it might be things that make fairly common sense, like the mafia or the police is probably the kind of things that we see more often. Sometimes you see things that are more bizarre, where they think the aliens are after them. So there's a huge variety in that as well. Referential delusions are usually referred to as ideas of reference. So these are beliefs that certain comments or environmental cues have special meaning for you. So in schizophrenia and other psychotic illnesses, what we see most commonly, I think the most common, the most well-known example of a referential delusion is a patient who believes that when they're watching television, that what the newscaster is saying has meaning for them. So they will come to me and say, I was watching the news and this guy was talking about some kind of a bomb, and now I know that somebody's going to come after me with a bomb for tomorrow. So it's that connection. They believe that and that's where the word referential is coming from, is the people believe that's what's being talked about on the television or on the radio, for example, is referring to them when it's not. So it happens also in a lot of other examples. One of the more common things that people will say, I had looked after a patient one time that I remember pretty well who went into a bar in some small town way up north. And he walked into the bar and he saw some woman holding her hand in a funny way, and he just knew that that meant he had to go upstairs. You know, and then he got upstairs and he heard some woman downstairs saying something else that was unrelated, and he just knew that that meant something. So he was doing this referential business where he was persuaded that things that had absolutely nothing to do with him were meant for him, and he was acting on these things. So those are ideas of reference, and they're very common in the world of schizophrenia and other psychotic disorders. Grandiose delusions are also pretty common. Grandiose delusions occur in schizophrenia and in the illnesses that we're going to talk about tonight, but they also occur in other places. So in putting it in rather simple terms, if you're grandiose in a delusional sense, you have an unshakable belief that you have special talents, that you're particularly wealthy when probably you're not, or that you're famous when you're not. So we would get, an example would be a fellow we had in the hospital recently who was quite convinced that he was the king of some country. And we have people coming in who think that they, you know, that they're Buddha, or they're clearly some very, very, very grandiose thought that they can't be persuaded otherwise. Erotomanic delusions, people will recognize this. These are people with illnesses who believe that there's another person in the world who's in love with them. So you hear about that on the radio and the news. These are usually people that believe that there's a famous, wonderful singer out there somewhere in the world who's in love with them, who they've never met. Also, we have nihilistic delusions. Nihilistic delusions are delusions in which a person is convinced that there's going to be horrible, terrible things happening. A person I knew pretty well last year got really quite sick, and he was he went to a board meeting, and in the board meeting he was sure that he'd made a small mistake, and he didn't really realize that until he started to get fairly sick, and then he believed that probably because he'd made this mistake in the board meeting for this company that the company was going to collapse. And because his family and friends had stocks in the company, he believed that his family was all going to come to financial ruin. And then he believed that because of all this, his reputation was going to be so tainted that he would never be able to work in his field again. And then he believed that because the whole world would know about him, that his kids would never be able to go to school in this province. And it just went on and on. It was a horrible thing. This guy was just in agony because he believed that he not only had ruined his life, he had ruined his wife's life, he had ruined his relatives' lives, his kids were going to end up in disaster, and just on and on and on and on. So it's a pretty frightening thing when you see it and when people truly believe that. Somatic delusions, these are delusions when people believe that there's truly something wrong with them physically. It's a delusion about some physical function or physical organ. A guy in the hospital recently, he was convinced his heart was made of cement and would never work again. So that's kind of an extreme somatic delusion. Sometimes we see people who, you know, believe that their skin is falling off. I saw a fellow last month, I think, who was on dialysis, and he was convinced that there was parasites crawling around under his skin. So these are delusions, and he was trying to cut these things out. He was pretty darn convinced that he had these things crawling around under his skin. He wasn't just wondering. He had knives and weapons to get rid of these things. And he was thinking about drinking insecticides to get rid of these parasites that were crawling around in his body. So these are kind of somatic delusions. And then bizarre delusions is just a descriptor really to suggest that sometimes people have delusions and they're hard to sort out, because if you get a girl coming to your office and saying that, you know, my nose is way too big, I mean, it could be a delusion. She could be just very self-conscious. But if somebody comes in and tells you they're building spaceships on a regular basis, it's pretty easier to sort that out. When people come in and, the more bizarre the delusion is, I guess it makes it a little easier for people to realize it without any doubt. You know, it is delusional, because really some people come and say to you that, you know, they've been, when they were younger, they participated. I saw a young girl last night who told me that when she was 23 or 24, she was hanging around in a bad crowd and they were doing a bunch of things that shouldn't have been done. And then she believed 5 years later that the people that she was with at the time were creating trouble for her, and now the leaders of the gang who were selling all these drugs in Red Deer were out to get her, and maybe they were going to tie her up and hurt her or beat her in some way. You know, on the surface of it all, it's pretty hard to know that is that really necessarily untrue. So sometimes, you know, you have to take the delusion that might be remotely plausible and take a look and see if they meet other symptoms in order to make the diagnosis. Because when somebody just comes in and says to me they're out to get me, clearly sometimes they are, right? So whereas with bizarre delusions, it's usually a whole lot easier to spot. So the other pretty common thing that is quite striking in the world of psychosis and the various psychotic disorders that we're going to talk about are hallucinations. So hallucinations are experiences that are perceived as perceptions. They're perception-like experience that occur without an external stimuli. So the most common type of hallucination in schizophrenia is an auditory hallucination, where people hear voices. And they hear voices when there isn't anything to be heard. So this is a person in a quiet room who's hearing a voice and is absolutely convinced that he's hearing a voice when there isn't any noise. It's also, and these things can also occur in any sensory modality. So I have a fellow in the hospital now who believes that the voice that he hears and the person whose voice that he's hearing can touch him. So he can feel this person touching him. So he's having delusions in more than one modality. He feels this person, he can hear this person, he doesn't see this person. But we also have visual hallucinations that are less common in schizophrenia than in other conditions, but they do occur. So auditory hallucinations are probably the most common. Visual hallucinations are present in schizophrenia, but less common in schizophrenia. And then people have tactile hallucinations where they feel things. People have olfactory hallucinations where they smell things, but less common. So the other thing, if you think back to the symptoms we talked about in the beginning. People with schizophrenia have delusions, they may have hallucinations, they may have disorganized thinking, and we measure their disorganized thinking by looking at how they speak. So really, when we say that your speech is disorganized, what we're trying to measure is how your thinking is going. So it's, of course, it's your thoughts that are disorganized. So with respect to thought disorder, which is often a pretty common phrase in the world of diagnosing people with schizophrenia, thought disorder is generally seen in these three situations or in these three examples. Sometimes people become so derailed in their thinking, or they show so much loosening of associations that when they talk, they'll be talking to you about a topic, and before you know it, they're on another topic, and you can't for the life of you imagine how they connected those two. So they literally are talking about their motorcycle, and the next minute, somehow they're suddenly talking about the weather in Spain, and there just isn't any connection that you can draw there to pull those two topics together. So we refer to this as loosening of associations. It's a term that's used very commonly in psychiatry whenever we examine somebody with a psychotic illness or any sort of serious mental health problem. We look to see if they lose track of what they're talking about and move on to completely unrelated topics. So they exist on a bit of a spectrum, but then we also have this form of thought disorder called tangential thinking or tangentiality, which means that probably all of us do this sometimes, that people start talking about something and then they shift to a new topic, but it's related. And then they go on to another new topic, but it's related. And when they're all done in 20 minutes, you think, how did we ever end up here when we started out talking about that? But if you go back and see how they moved from topic to topic to topic, they're related. So that's kind of the difference between loosening of associations, where we have people talking in a sequence where there isn't any association, and people talking about things that are completely unrelated. And then in an extreme example, we don't see this very commonly, people are unable to be coherent enough in their thinking, and therefore their speech appears completely incoherent, where they will give you words that aren't, the words themselves are not connected. And then it's just like a jumble of words that you can't make any sense out of. So they're enunciating the words carefully. All these words are coming out of their mouth. It doesn't make any sense at all what they're talking about. People often refer to that as word salad or incoherence. It's not horribly common, but in the acute setting in the hospital, you know, we see it relatively frequently and when somebody's really quite ill and is first admitted. So now we've talked about hallucinations, delusions, and we've talked about disorganized thinking that's represented, we see in their speech patterns. Then we see a lot of motor activity that changes in this illness. So as I said before, we have five symptoms that we say you must have two out of the five in order to make a diagnosis of schizophrenia. This disordered motor activity in the extreme is not very common. It's mostly associated with a condition called catatonia. Catatonia used to be a subtype of schizophrenia. It's not anymore. In our last diagnostic book, we had different types of schizophrenia. We talked about hebephrenic schizophrenia. We talked about paranoid schizophrenia. We talked about catatonic schizophrenia and undifferentiated schizophrenia. Now we just talk about schizophrenia. And the only one, you talk about schizophrenia, but if you think that your patient has significant catatonic features, at the end of your diagnostic summary, you would note that they have catatonic features. So we don't have catatonic schizophrenia anymore. But it'll be a while, because this new book that we have out is fairly new. It'll be a while before everybody sort of figures that out. So we're still sort of halfway in between diagnosing people with the old book and the new book and using terms from the old book and the new book. So we're kind of stuck in the middle right now. So we're going to talk just a little bit about what some of this motor changes can be. Sometimes we see people that just seem to be acting in a very silly fashion, and that's considered an abnormal motor manifestation of schizophrenia. I have a lady in the hospital now who's not my patient actually, but you know, she's a 45-year-old lady who clearly, if you watch the way she moves, and she's always got a little animal with her, and she's very ill, but you can also see that she's just acting in a very childlike fashion, and you would say she's wandering around looking like a 13-year-old. So she's doing this kind of childlike silliness stuff, and some of the stuff that she talks about is kind of silly. So Catatonia really refers to a marked decrease in the reactivity to the environment. So when we see catatonic patients, and catatonia doesn't just show up in schizophrenia, it shows up in a number of situations, but when you see catatonic patients or people with catatonic features, sometimes we talk about negativism. So if I go in and see a patient and ask them if they would, if I suspect the patient is catatonic or has some catatonic symptoms, I might test my little theory by asking them to pass me something on their bedside table, and they won't. But, you know, clearly if I'm not asking them to do something or the nurses are looking later, they're quite happy to move their pen around. So it's just a negativism thing, and you ask the patient to do something and they purposely, seemingly, intentionally don't do it. So, and that's a decrease in reactivity to the environment, because of me being the person in their environment, I'm asking them to do something and they react in a negative way by not doing it. And in some cases, you see people doing the opposite. So you might see some patient in theory and ask them to do something a little quicker, and they'll do it more slowly. It's a rather interesting, catatonia is interesting. So we get this negativistic stuff going on, more classical pictures that you might see in the movies and things is, occasionally we see people with a catatonic condition where they'll adopt an unusual picture or posture and not move. So, you know, often in the movies you'll see people that will stand motionless in a corner for an hour or for a day. I've had people who probably would do that for 2 or 3 days at a time, but of course the nurses would try and move them. People will stand on one leg for an hour or two at a time, and this is not common, but when you see it, it's really quite striking. So they adopt odd postures and hold them for long periods of time. So in addition to this posturing and negativism, we see this purposeless excessive motor activity sometimes. So I had a fellow that I know really well that I've looked after for 20 years who's a manic depressive fellow. Usually when he comes in and he's manic, he's catatonic. So probably in the last, he went for 10 years, he was never in the hospital, then in the last year he's been in and out 2 or 3 times. And I went to see him in emergency about a year ago. He was mute. He wouldn't speak to me. He hadn't spoken to his wife for a couple of days. She finally brought him in to hospital because she was worried about him. And I took his arm and I stuck it up in the air and he just held it there. And he wasn't about to move it unless somebody put it back. So that's the kind of catatonic stuff that you see that is kind of interesting. And they have other sort of motor changes. If you take their arm or some limb and move it back and forth, you can feel that it's not moving fluidly, that it's kind of waxy and it's slow. So they call it waxy flexibility that I don't think I've actually put on the slide. So these are all sort of changes in motor behavior. Some of them sound pretty extreme. These are not things that we see horribly often. We see some grimacing sometimes. We see people that just refuse to answer your questions and they're mute. Sometimes if you ask, rarely if you say to somebody, how are you this morning, Mrs. Smith? They'll say back to me, how are you this morning, Mrs. Smith? So they're echoing me. I see that once every 5 years. So because it's such a noticeable thing and a curious phenomenon, it ends up being talked about, but it's not common. It's important to realize, I think, that because in our last few editions of the diagnostic manual, we talked about catatonic schizophrenia. We thought that there was a type of schizophrenia that was called catatonic schizophrenia. And I think because of that, whenever we say catatonia, we think that we're talking about schizophrenia. It's more common in bipolar illness. It's fairly common in some personality disorders. It's not uncommon in depression. So you can see catatonic stuff in lots of different places. This year, I think in hospital, I've had 4 people that were catatonic. One was a lady who was undergoing enormous stress. She was catatonic for a day and a half. And then it went away. One was my bipolar fellow that I just told you about, who was catatonic for a week. And we had a girl come in from Panoka who was motionless and mute and refused to participate in anything. And they were worried that she wasn't eating, and so she was brought to Red Deer so we could manage her nutritional state better. She was catatonic for probably 10 days. So one bipolar, 2 or 3 people under enormous stress. And yeah, I forget who the other one was. So I don't think I've really seen a patient with schizophrenia that was catatonic in the last year, actually, that I can think of. But they have some mild symptoms, because sometimes you see people with excessive motor activity or little motor activity. And sometimes those are connected with catatonic symptoms. The other thing with catatonia is you always, when you see this, I was asked to go to the pediatric ward not too horribly long ago to see a catatonic boy. And of course everybody's thinking, oh, we have to do antipsychotic drugs and maybe we should do these other whole bunch of psychiatric treatments. He'd been using a bunch of street drugs. So drugs can do that, medications can do that, neurological illnesses can do that, and a variety of psychiatric illnesses can do that. So the negative symptoms of schizophrenia are perhaps not as interesting or as unique or grab your attention quite as much, but they're concerning because they have a huge impact on how well your patient is going to do over the long term, and they have a huge impact on how your patient is going to do this particular week in the hospital. So the negative symptoms are very important and they're often not paid enough attention to. So they don't occur as commonly in other psychotic illnesses. The negative symptoms that are most common are this diminished emotional expression and avolition, or reduced motor activity. So we're going to explain that a little more. So avolition or diminished, we talk about flattened affect quite a lot. So this is somebody that comes into your office, or you meet up with this person somewhere and they don't show the usual expected range of emotion. And of course this doesn't happen with everybody that has schizophrenia. But for some people, you know, if you tell them a joke, or they just sort of look at you rather stoically, if you, you know, ask them to walk across the room, they are kind of slow in how they do it, they don't swing their arms, there's just a general lack of motor activity. And you can see that in facial expression, you can see that in alterations in eye contact, they don't have the same inflections or intonation of speech, their speech is kind of monotone, they don't move around and flap their arms around as much as some of us do. So it's just a general reduction in motor activity. So here we have this definition of avolition as a reduction in self-motivated, self-initiated, purposeful activities. So if you have that and you have schizophrenia and you have this symptom, you know, these people, basically what we're saying is they tend to sit around a whole lot, they don't get up and do very much, they kind of seem to be hanging out more than doing anything very much, and it's a big problem because, you know, you're not going to do very well in the workforce if you don't seem to develop self-initiated, self-motivated activity. And if you're just kind of physically slow in the workforce, it causes problems. So some of the other negative symptoms include these three: allogia, anhedonia, and asociality. These are the definitions. Allogia is just reduced speech output, so often people with this illness don't have as much to say. Anhedonia is a reduced ability to enjoy yourself. That's fairly common in this illness. It also happens in depression and some other psychiatric conditions. And asociality is just as a fancy word that means an apparent lack of interest in social things. They don't get involved in much. People that have this symptom don't get involved in a whole lot. They don't seem to be interested. But again, I need to remind you that there are a lot of people with this illness that don't have any of these symptoms. So we're just going through the possible symptom constellations. So as I tried to say in the beginning, there's a huge range of constellation of symptoms. This illness involves a range of some cognitive, some behavioral, and some emotional dysfunctions. There isn't any one single symptom that always occurs in every patient with schizophrenia. There's no one symptom that I can see in a patient and say, oh, I know what you have, because every symptom that we've talked about today can occur elsewhere. So there's no one symptom. Illness. People that have this illness will vary tremendously, as we've suggested earlier, in being quite heterogeneous or quite variable in their clinical picture. Generally, there's impairment in areas of functioning. So usually, you will find that people with this illness, over the course of their illness, will have periods, long periods or perhaps short periods, where there's definite problems with their functioning. So that could be problems in social functioning, it could be problems in work, could be problems looking after themselves, could be problems going to school. The problems can be permanent, the problems can be short-lived, the problems can sometimes be reversed. These are symptoms. And this business of, you know, if you don't initiate much self-motivated activity, it will give you problems with social in the world of social activities. So the two are kind of linked. There's also there's a lot of evidence, which is quite impressive, that shows a relationship between cognitive impairment and functional impairment. So clearly, you know, if your thinking is slowed, if your ability to think through complex tasks is impaired, your ability to function in an environment when your executive functioning or your more advanced cognitive functioning isn't working as well as other people's, you'll have impairment in function, whether that's work or academic or socially. And again, these are not things that occur in everybody that has schizophrenia. So we've talked now about what schizophrenia looks like once the diagnosis is made or once the person has an established diagnosis of schizophrenia. So for the majority of people that have schizophrenia, for a period of time before the diagnosis is made, they have changes in their symptomatology and changes in their behavior. So the most common thing we would see, I think, would be somebody comes and tells me that now you have my son in hospital and he clearly seems to have all the symptoms of schizophrenia. And they tell me that for the last 3 years in high school, perhaps, that he seemed to be less interested in his friends, that he wasn't looking after himself as well as he used to, that he wasn't getting his marks that were as good as he used to get. So you see this prodromal period where it seems like there might, often people describe it, there seems to be a personality change, or my son or my daughter is changing and they're not as enthusiastic and as outgoing before there are some real symptoms that allow us to make the diagnosis. So typically, in the beginning of this illness, for a while before people have enough symptoms to make the diagnosis, there's a change in how they are, which if you're able to catch that before they ever truly have enough criteria to make the diagnosis, then like anything else, the earlier in the game you get on top of these illnesses and the earlier in the game you bring them under control, then the better your patient will do. But trying to spot a prodrome is really pretty difficult, because you can kind of imagine that, you know, if you had a boy or a daughter who was going through high school perhaps and just seemed to be more moody and stuck in her room more often and wasn't as social as she used to be for 6 months, you'd probably just write off to hormones or teenagers or problems. And you know, it's not often that parents come in and say, I worry my son is developing a serious illness. People don't often spot this. And usually if there are symptoms, apart from the ones I talked about, if there are any delusions or hallucinations, they're not quite reaching the criteria for a delusion or a hallucination. So this is where you might see somebody who says, I think they're out to get me, but they're not really. At night when I go to bed, I sometimes think for a minute that I see something in the corner of my room, but then I realize I don't. So these are not quite meeting the stringent criteria for a hallucination or a delusion. So then often people in this phase of illness, in the prodrome, engage in thinking that is a bit odd or different. So they might believe that there's meaning in a book that has special meaning for them. They might think the newscaster is saying something that somehow is related to them, or they do more of this magical thinking thing, and that's just that business, I don't know what people talk about so much these days, but when I was young, people used to say, you're walking down the sidewalk and you don't step on a crack or your mother will get sick, or you don't walk under stepladders. It's that sort of magical thinking that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And we don't pay much attention to that, but it's interesting that it occurs in the prodrome of schizophrenia often. So we do have negative symptoms in the prodrome. So as I said, in the prodromal period, often people aren't as energetic, they're not as outgoing, they're not as social, and they have some cognitive decline. So the other place where, I guess I'll talk about it in a later slide, but we sort of see these symptoms of schizophrenia that are primarily the negative symptoms without any active delusions or hallucinations in the early phases of the illness. And again, then as people get older, and more often than not, the hallucinations or delusions, if they still have those things, tend to settle down. So you might end up with a patient who's been actively schizophrenic or having some active schizophrenic symptoms for quite a few years, and as they get older, they might all vanish, but you still often are left with this lack of interest in social things, sort of a slowing of motor activity, some impairment in cognition. Sometimes you see that at the beginning of the illness and at the end. So we've talked now mostly about the diagnostic symptoms that are associated with schizophrenia. So now what we're going to talk about are not things that are necessarily associated with schizophrenia. There are things that are found fairly commonly in schizophrenia, and they lend some credibility to your diagnosis. So these are things that, you know, that are useful. You look for them, but they aren't necessarily always found in schizophrenia. So these are things that are fairly commonly found in schizophrenia, but not frequently enough that they really help us a lot with a diagnosis. So having something called an inappropriate affect is not terribly uncommon. I was talking to some guy last night that I've known for a long time, and he was telling me he's very worried about his mother, who's in Calgary, who's getting pretty old, and she's had some health problems, and we were talking about sad things, and he started laughing. So that's very inappropriate affect. Sometimes you get the opposite, where people will actually say to me as they're getting better, I remember, you know, when I was ill and people were talking about happy things and I was crying. So you can just get this inappropriate affect business. So when you see that, it really doesn't occur in very many places other than in psychotic illnesses. Most of the time you don't see it. People can have a dysphoric mood, which is kind of an unhappy mood. Often it's people can have kind of a sadness thing or an irritability thing or an anxious thing or an angry kind of mood that is associated with the illness. Often it's there, certainly not always, probably not, I don't know, 20, 25% of the time. People often sleep too much, sometimes they sleep too little. People more with schizophrenia and psychotic illnesses more commonly experience depersonalization. It's just a sense that you're not who you are. So people come in and say, I really don't feel like myself today, but they're not saying I didn't have enough sleep. They're saying I'm really questioning if I'm myself. It's a profound sense of I really don't feel like this is me. Or they have this other thing called derealization, where people will walk into their bedroom and they're almost convinced that this isn't really my room. So with derealization, it's the world around them doesn't any longer seem real or the way it should. And with depersonalization, their personal sense of who they are doesn't seem solid. So you see those things fairly commonly. We see them in lots of people with anxiety disorders, people that don't have any sort of disorders. And they happen in lots of places. They don't help us a whole lot in making the diagnosis. So the cognitive changes in schizophrenia, not surprisingly, if you have significant cognitive changes in schizophrenia and your thinking is more slowed, your concentration is impaired, then probably that will result in some problems for you at work or possibly when you go to school or in general function. Cognitive impairments can lead to problems obviously in social arenas as well as in the work area. And we see problems such as declarative memory where some people with schizophrenia, if you ask them to report what you've done in the last week, they won't do that as well as most people would. If you ask them to give you an example, if you watch them function in trying to measure something like what we call working memory, when you go to work and you're sitting at your desk and you have to do your job, then you have to remember what your job is, you have to remember the numbers that you're supposed to work with, you have to remember what the outcome of your purpose for that day is. So it's putting together a whole bunch of stuff to allow you to do what they call working memory. It's pretty fancy. It's not just saying, tell me who was in your office yesterday. It's a much more complicated executive functioning type of memory. If those things are impaired, it's going to cause you trouble in a variety of areas. So other associated features. One of the curious things about this illness is many, many people, I don't know, a very significant number of people who have this illness don't think they're sick. Or very significant people who have this illness don't think they have the symptoms that we're asking about. So it's a big problem. If you don't believe that you have this illness, then when you leave the hospital, why in the world would you take your medication? And that's where the problem comes in, I think, for the most part. You can't expect somebody who doesn't believe for a second that they're ill to energetically go out and comply with treatment, whether that's coming to see me or taking their medications or anything else that I might suggest to help them with their illness. If they don't think they have an illness, they're not going to do it. So then, you know, it leads to enormous problems because people come in the hospital, we hopefully get them feeling pretty well, then they go home and they don't take their medications, and they don't come back and see me, and then 6 months later, perhaps they're in the hospital again, then you start all over again. So now across the country and across the world, we're sort of implementing strategies to gently or more forcibly compel people to stay on medications so that you hope that if you can force somebody to stay on medications for long enough, which sometimes takes 6 months, sometimes takes 2 years, that they will eventually come into you and say, I understand now that I have an illness and now I'm willing to work with you. So we had a really happy experience in our building. In the last few months, we had a young guy that we've worked with for probably 3 or 4 years. He's been in the hospital probably 5 or 6 times. He's now on what they call a community treatment order. He basically has to take his medications. And before that, he popped in and out of hospital like a yo-yo. Now he must take his medications. 2.5 years after, 2.5 years of knowing this guy after he left the hospital, me arguing with him every time he came to see me, him being angry with me every time he came to see me because I was wanting him to take his medications. I was making him take his medications. Him not, couldn't imagine why I'd want to do that because he didn't think for a second there was anything wrong with him. 2.5 years later, he came in and announced to us that he apologized, that he now realized that we were right and he had this illness. But it's amazing to me that it took 2.5 years, which I think is a really, you know, and that's, I'm not going to talk a lot about community treatment orders. I wasn't planning on talking about them at all. But if you can find any way to get somebody to take their medications for a long period of time, it's interesting to me that we're seeing that after 2 years and after 3 years, people are still improving, which surprises me because I think we used to think 6 months or a year, and then whatever you've got, that's just probably about as good as it's going to get. But for this young guy to come in after 2.5 years and now be quite enthusiastic about seeing what we can do for him is a pretty encouraging, it's an extremely encouraging thing. So it's a good thing, obviously, very good. So this is a pretty good word, eh? It's a nosognosia. It's a fancy word that just means that what I just explained. It's a word that people have no insight into their illness. They either don't believe for a second that they have an illness, or there are parts of their illness that they don't understand. For the most part, it's full-blown. For the most people, for the most part, they just don't believe they have an illness. And it's horrendously challenging to treat that, you know, because it's a tricky illness. You might need to adjust medications for various reasons. You might need to increase them. You might need to add side effect medications. And when these people are not happy about coming to see you because they don't have any idea why you want anything to do with them because they don't think that they're sick, they're not going to work with you to help you figure out should you adjust their medications up a little bit or down a little bit, or maybe we should adjust your side effect medication, maybe we should phone the college and ask them to give you some special help, or I don't know, all sorts of things. I mean, it's very difficult to work with people who don't believe that there's any point in them being in your office or taking medications. Okay, I think I've said enough about that. So I'll emphasize this. So if you don't understand that you're ill, then there's a mistake on this slide, which I think is the last mistake that's on the slide. But if you don't believe that you're ill, you're going to have more involuntary treatments, which means that one way or another, you will be compelled by me or the RCMP or somebody, you'll be forced into a hospitalization against your will. So if you don't understand that you're sick, one of the horrible consequences is you keep ending up being thrown back in the hospital. If you don't understand that you're sick and you go off your medications and on your medications and off and on and off and on, you will of course have more poor psychosocial functioning. It's also a predictor of aggressive behavior, and it's a predictor of a worse course of the illness. So people who work with you carefully to get the best outcomes you can get, not surprisingly, do well. People that can't understandably be expected to work with you energetically because they can't imagine why they would do that typically don't do as well until they become insightful. So then a second separate point, hostility and aggression is sometimes associated with schizophrenia. It's pictured that way in some of the movies. It makes better movies, I guess. It's a very nasty, unfair thing that they do with psychotic illness and some other psychiatric disorders. They will lead you to believe that schizophrenia is significantly more commonly associated with violence, and it's really not. So I sort of said this, we don't have any laboratory tests, we have no radiological tests that can pinpoint this illness. We do know, however, that in different brain regions and different peoples, we can identify problems, but not so that the same abnormality in the brain occurs in every patient that has this illness. So we do know, for example, that in people with schizophrenia, we have some evidence from radiological X-ray stuff, some evidence from autopsy studies, and some neurophysiological studies where we're measuring cellular function, that there are differences in many people who have schizophrenia. So we see differences in the actual structure of the cells. We see differences in the rate of electrical conductivity in the white matter of the brain and in the actual volume of brain matter in some people's brains that have this illness. If that, you know, happened in everybody that had this illness, or even in most people that had this illness, it would be a big help diagnostically, but it doesn't. So the research is sort of moving along. We're getting to know more and more, but we haven't come to where we'd like to be yet. The incidence of schizophrenia is generally put at 1%. It varies a bit between 0.5 and probably 1 and a bit, so 1 in 100. So how does the illness go? How does it develop? Typically between the late teenage years and the mid-30s, this illness shows up. Usually there's a period of a prodrome before that where people don't have active symptoms of schizophrenia, but things are changing. So the most common average peak onset age is in the early to mid-20s for males and a little bit later for females. The illness can occur overnight, extremely abruptly, but not commonly. Generally, it's a slow, insidious process. So it creeps up on people. In about 20% of people, the illness is considered to have a favorable profile. So 20% of people, they do pretty well with their lives, I guess is what they're trying to say. In a smaller percentage of people, the illness seems to go away completely. There's a small percentage of people, even these days, who probably will have a very unfortunate course. So it's, again, it's extremely variable, and you just don't know what to tell people until you've known them for a long time, which is a difficult thing. You know, when you have somebody, you know, I have a young guy in the hospital recently who came in from Red Deer College, I guess, and you know, his family, of course, are really worried what's going on with this kid. I don't really know what's going on because he doesn't quite meet the diagnosis for anything yet, but there's something going on. And they want to know if he has schizophrenia, what's it going to look like in 10 years? Well, I don't know. You know, so it's hard for families, and it's hard for me to say, I'm sorry, we have to wait. But really, when you talk about how is my daughter going to do with her diabetes now that you've diagnosed her at age 17, you're kind of saying the same thing. You have to watch for a while. How is a 25-year-old going to do with their hypertension? You have to watch for a while. Sometimes there are indicators that will help you say, I don't think this is going to go well, or I think this is going to go really well. But even those are not guaranteed, right? So it's an awkward illness that can be, because we know sometimes people don't do well, we know sometimes people do well, and you're trying to paint a fair picture to the family without giving them a distorted view. So it's difficult, because asking people to be patient around a topic that's not easy to be patient around. Did I get all that? So most people with illness, you know, continue to require some sort of support in their daily lives. So whether that's coming to the clinic once in a while to see a nurse, somebody coming to see you, financial support, big brother, I mean, most people require something. Most people require something, not everybody. So psychotic symptoms tend to diminish as people get older, I've said that. The negative symptoms are actually more closely related to how your patient is going to do. So if you have a patient come into hospital that doesn't seem to have any interest in having a shower, doesn't seem to care if he ever gets out of bed, doesn't care if his friends come to visit him, that's probably more reliable as a negative prognostic indicator than somebody that comes in that's having all sorts of hallucinations and delusions and it looks like their brain is just going wild on them. The negative symptoms are a more reliable indicator of prognosis, but it doesn't come with any kind of guarantee. Cognitive deficits that are associated with the illness may or may not improve over the course of the illness. And then we have a group of people that seem to develop this illness later in life, after the age of 40. Most of them are women. Most of these women who develop this illness when they're 40 to 50 don't have as many problems with emotional expression, so they usually maintain their emotional reactivity. They're usually, you know, therefore are still pretty good at maintaining friendships, enjoying things, being sad, being happy. They don't get that flattened affect that we talked about before. So there is a pretty significant genetic contribution to this, and then the second statement seems kind of contradictory. Whereas the majority of people diagnosed with this illness we can't find any evidence in their family tree. So I don't know if that means that your great-grandfather had it, and he died when he was 17, so nobody knew, or with your great-great-grandfather had it and nobody ever talked about it, because, of course, three generations back, nobody talked about this stuff. But we also know that there's a fair number of people who have difficulties around birth, sort of prenatal problems, perinatal things, including stress, infection, malnutrition, maternal diabetes. All of these things in the prenatal and perinatal periods have been linked with schizophrenia. So we look at schizophrenia in the world of psychiatry as one of the most genetically, it's most linked to genetics, I think, compared to any other illness that we have. But having said that, it's interesting that more than half the people, we can't find anybody in their family that has it. So we always ask about it. If we find it, we do appropriately apply weight to that, but it's not always there. So then with respect to gender differences, there are a number of differences in females and males. There's a bit fewer females that have this. I said a minute ago, it tends to start up a little later in women. Sometimes in women between age 40 and 45 or 40 and 50, this kind of illness will show up. Very rarely you'll see somebody where this is happening between 50 and 65, but occasionally, probably once every couple of years, I see that. Women tend to maintain their affect a little more than men. It's not something that you can always say either. Other symptom differences include less frequent negative symptoms and less frequent disorganization in women. And social functioning tends to remain better preserved. 5 to 6% of people with this illness will die from suicide. 20% of them will attempt at some time in their life. Sometimes people commit suicide because they don't want to carry on with their life. The frequency of depression with schizophrenia is fairly high. Probably 40% of people with schizophrenia will have a serious depressive illness at some time in their life, which of course would predispose them at that time to a suicide risk. And sometimes people have hallucinations that are command hallucinations. So people fairly often with this illness have voices telling them what to do. So if the voice is telling you walk across the street or put on your shoes, nobody's going to worry about it too much. If the voice is telling you to go get a gun and shoot somebody, then we would worry about that. So that's a fairly uncommon thing. But whenever we hear that voices are telling people to do things, we inquire about it, because occasionally you run into people that have some voices that would predispose them to significant dangerousness. And suicide risk remains high over the entire lifespan. The substance abuse thing escalates the suicide risk very considerably. Functional consequences, I think we've been through this a bit. Schizophrenia is associated with significant social and occupational function. Again, we see huge variety in that. Some people are afflicted with this impairment and others are not. Problems with education, problems maintaining employment are pretty common these days. And I think, I guess that's one of the things that we've said repeatedly, that the negative symptomatology of schizophrenia are probably the ones that cause people most problems. The negative symptoms and the cognitive symptoms are the ones that give you trouble in the workplace and give you trouble functioning socially. And the medications, the new medications that we've had around for a bit more than 10 years, were functioning because of this. Because of this, of course, the pharmaceutical companies and the research people are working very hard to find drugs that are working more effectively on the negative symptoms. So probably for the first half of my career, the medications that we had typically did next to nothing for the negative symptoms. And so we ended up with people that really didn't seem to have much fun in their life. They rarely had relationships. They didn't care about relationships. They didn't seem to be enjoying their life. And then I found that a more difficult situation to work with, I think. And now, the last generation of antipsychotic drugs that we have, some of them are really quite impressive in their impact on the negative symptoms. So that's nice that we're going in that direction. The recognition that the negative symptoms play a huge role in the total cumulative impairment that these people suffer is important, and I think it's guiding the direction of research, and there's lots more medication coming down the tube. Unfortunately, if you think about it, this illness has traditionally been a very expensive illness. A lot of people with this illness are impaired in their ability to work, so they're on some form of disability. A lot of people are supported entirely on disability. There are still a lot of people, mostly people who developed this illness 30 years ago, that are still in the hospital bed and maybe for the rest of their lives. So we don't see that kind of thing happening so much anymore, but the country is still paying an enormous price. So of course, there's financial motivation to find better treatments and better drugs, and we're getting much better treatments and better drugs. So substances, this slide is mostly about substances. This illness, people with this illness are much more likely to get involved in substances than people that are not. Half the people with schizophrenia smoke cigarettes. Anxiety disorders are much more common in schizophrenia than they are in people that don't have schizophrenia. Obsessive compulsive disorder and panic disorder are much more common in schizophrenia compared to somebody who doesn't have it. And then certain types of personality styles seem to be more common with schizophrenia than in others. There is a type of personality in North America called a schizotypal personality disorder. It's been in our books for quite a long time. And it's classified in North America as being a personality style in which people have unusual or odd beliefs, and they sort of behave in rather eccentric ways. They have eccentric beliefs, not to the point that they have a lot of delusions or hallucinations. They might have some quasi-hallucinations or quasi-delusions, and so they look like a very mild variation of somebody with a mild schizophrenic disorder. In North America, we consider that a personality disorder. In Europe, they consider it a form of a psychotic illness. So it's probably just another good example of making sure people understand that our knowledge of diagnosing people with all sorts of mental illness is still evolving every year, which is why we come up with new diagnostic textbooks every once in a while. So especially in the world of personality disorder, I think there's lots of conflictual views in how we should conceptualize these individuals. Some of the medications that we use cause alterations in how people metabolize lipids, and therefore we get people having a higher frequency of dyslipidemia or needing higher cholesterol lipids and needing to be on treatment for that. People with schizophrenia, because of the medications in part, are more likely to develop type 2 diabetes, so they're developing a diabetes secondary to another condition. And people also are more likely to have high blood pressure and to gain weight. So when you put all those things together, it's a combination of all of those things that adds up to be something called the metabolic syndrome, which is, again, something that people are really focusing on right now, because we kind of got into this conundrum where some of the medications that we have that are great at reversing the negative symptoms and allowing people to function a lot better and to be a lot happier have some of these new side effects. So now we're trying to find, now we're into a kind of a new stream of things where we're looking for drugs that are very effective in reducing the negative symptoms and helping people to function better but don't cause the weight gain. So now, yeah, and I'll talk about that a little more in a minute. So I'm going to talk just briefly about something called delusional disorder. So delusional disorder, so now we've moved away from the schizophrenia spectrum disorders. Now we're talking about a psychotic disorder that is not in the spectrum of schizophrenia. So a delusional disorder is quite simply a disorder in which somebody has a delusion, which goes on for 1 month or longer. The patient has never been diagnosed as being schizophrenic, and they don't have a lot of impairment other than the impairment that would be expected to be caused by the delusion. And if the patient has manic or depressive episodes, then we wouldn't make this diagnosis probably, because more than likely their delusions are related to their mood disorder. So I guess a good example of a delusional disorder would be somebody who, I think I have some examples, I do. So subtypes of delusional disorders, the erotomanic type. So these are the people that we talked about a little earlier, where the central theme of the delusion is that another person is in love with the individual. So the reason that we talked about this earlier is this can be a symptom of schizophrenia. But when you have this by itself without any other symptoms, then it's referred to as delusional disorder. And if you have this belief that another person is usually a famous person or somebody who's very important is truly in love with you, you know, then we have an erotomanic subtype of a delusional disorder. Grandiose subtype of delusional disorder, where the central theme of the delusion is that the person has made some great important discovery or has great talent, or sometimes is somebody who's extremely important. So the jealous type of delusional disorder are people that are preoccupied with delusional jealousy to the point that it's delusional. So that's a bit difficult to sort out because there are a lot of people out there that are suspicious and paranoid about whether their wives or whether their husbands are having extramarital relationships or whether they're doing those sorts of things. When that belief reaches delusional conviction and they believe that they know positively that their partner is having extramarital affairs, and they come and they show you evidence, which, and usually the evidence is, you know, I came home one night and, you know, her underwear drawer wasn't quite closed, or I came home one night and the hot water tap wasn't turned off, and so the guy makes the assumption that she had a shower before he came home. So when it reaches a delusional proportion, this is a bit of a concerning thing. Persecutory type is, as you'd expect, the primary theme of the delusions is paranoia. This is probably more common, where we have paranoid people who have delusions of paranoia, have no other symptoms of schizophrenia, but are impaired in their existence by their delusions of paranoia. And the last one is the somatic type. So again, as I told you earlier, somatic delusions can occur in the setting of schizophrenia. If you have a somatic delusion and you don't have schizophrenia, then the central theme would involve bodily functions or sensations. Probably the most common one is that the patient believes that they have a foul odor, or that they're infested, or that there's a parasite inside them, or that some part of their body is the wrong shape, or that they're ugly, or things like that. So this can be quite problematic. This can be. I went to see a guy a few days ago who the fellow in ICU thought this fellow had the parasitic infestation, and probably every second or third year we see people like that. When I was a very young guy, one of the professors that I worked with wanted to do a study on patients who had this delusions of infestation, which at that time was called Ekbom's syndrome. So he brought 30 people in from around Western Canada into one of the wards at the University Hospital who all believed that they had parasites and bugs crawling around under their skin. And it was quite educational for me. It was very disturbing for patients because they were absolutely convinced they had these things. They were making all sorts of various efforts to get rid of these creatures. And the good news was that it was, generally speaking, very easily fixed. But it's often, you know, a lot of these people get admitted to hospital and people start looking to see if there really are parasites and if there really are creatures that are infesting them, and they don't always get in. Most of the time they probably don't get in to see a psychiatrist. So this was probably the last or second last psychotic disorder I wanted to talk about. So schizoaffective disorder is essentially a disorder that resembles schizophrenia for the most part, but throughout the duration of the illness of schizophrenia, there's a very prominent mood element. So these people have an elevated mood that is almost consistent with a manic episode, or a depressive mood that's almost consistent with a major depressive illness. So when you see people that seem to have schizophrenia essentially, but for a significant portion of time over the course of their illness, they're in what looks like a manic state, or they have grandiose delusions and are very manic and very happy and very excitable, or severely depressed all the time, then we seem to be seeing a combination of a serious mood disorder superimposed on a schizoaffective illness, on a schizophrenic disorder. And then they've come up with this term schizoaffective, which has been around for a while. So the bipolar subtype is the type where people do have euphoric periods of time during their schizophrenic picture, and the depressive subtype is the type where they have only depressions. Bipolar type can have euphoria and depression, and the depression people don't ever have the manic type. So I think the important thing, this has changed a wee bit. So in the last edition of our diagnostic manual, which was the fourth edition, they said that when somebody comes into your hospital and is having a schizophrenic episode, so if they have an episode that's been going on for 3 months, and for most of that episode they look like they're very depressed or they're manic, we call that schizoaffective. Now they've changed it. So now in order to say that somebody is schizoaffective and has a schizoaffective disorder, you have to look at their illness over the course of their life. So you have to be able to say, for example, the last 20 years that this patient has had schizophrenia, they seem to have had a superimposed mood episode going on for most of the time. So this is kind of an example. If you have somebody who's had a 4-year history of schizophrenia and they develop a combination of depressive and manic symptoms, that when you add all these periods of depression and mania together, it adds up to about a year. That doesn't meet the criteria for being the majority of the illness, because obviously 1 year out of four isn't majority. So it's kind of shifted. So when we're talking schizoaffective now, we're talking looking at the majority of time over the course of your entire illness, not just over the course of this episode. So the other little thing I'll just touch on briefly is, unfortunately these days we see a lot of this in the emergency room, we see a lot of this in our hospital on the wards, people coming in using substances that are making them psychotic. So these people typically present in order to get a diagnosis of a substance-induced or medication-induced psychotic illness. You must have either delusions or hallucinations, and quite commonly both. And then in order to make this diagnosis, not surprisingly, you have to be able to say that these symptoms developed during exposure to this substance or soon after. So an example would be somebody coming in using LSD, or crystal meth, PCP, who's psychotic. So because you know that that drug that they're using can cause people to be psychotic. Or the other part of it is somebody comes into your hospital and they're not using any drugs and they've come in to have their gallbladder taken out, and on the fifth day of the hospital they start seeing things. On their fifth day in the hospital they start seeing things or hearing things or acting very paranoid, and you do some checking and discover that they've been drinking all their life, then they're having delirium tremens, so they have DTs. So this is a substance-induced psychotic disorder because it's related to the alcohol, but it's related not to intoxication but to withdrawal. So these substances can cause substance-induced psychotic disorders. Alcohol doesn't cause this in intoxication generally, but with DTs and withdrawal it commonly does. So this happens in our hospital a lot. We get a lot of kind of closet alcoholics that nobody has any idea how much they're drinking. They come in, they decide not to tell the doctor that they've been drinking a bottle of wine every day, and 3 days into their hospitalization they're psychotic. So then people call me wondering what the heck is going on, and they're having alcohol withdrawal. Marijuana can cause psychosis. You know, that's always I feel like I talk about that in my practice quite a lot, because the world thinks that marijuana is such an innocent substance, and without any doubt there was a time perhaps when I was very young or a lot 20 years ago and the marijuana that people purchased was much less potent than what we have now, and there was a time these days I think when often when you buy marijuana you don't know what the heck else is in there. So these days we see a fair number of young guys that come into our emergency room and they're paranoid and they have delusions, and you find out they're smoking a whole bunch of pot every day. And so then you admit them, and if you take away the pot, then usually they get better fairly quickly. Sometimes it might take a month, but usually within a month that resolves. But it seems like that's changing all the time, because I am sure that 10 years ago people who came in psychotic smoking pot were better overnight or in 2 days. Now it's pretty common for it to be 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, and I've seen a few people now where it's going on for 5 or 6 weeks and then it does get better. So even though the criteria tells us that if your patient has a marijuana-induced psychosis and is still there in a month, the book would say then it's not marijuana. But we do see people now that come in smoking marijuana, they're sick for 4 to 6 weeks and then they all get better. So clearly it was marijuana, and I think that's a function of how powerful the stuff is that people are getting these days. It's a frequent conversation with young people, because young people you know, there's this big movement out there to legalize marijuana. They are legalizing marijuana in parts of the world. There's something to be said that alcohol will destroy your liver and you will die. Marijuana won't kill you by destroying your liver, but marijuana will cause you serious mental health problems, possibly. And it's hard to convince young people of that because, you know, they think that, well, you haven't really read the latest. Don't you really know that marijuana is good for you? And you get into these big arguments with young people. It's pretty difficult, and it's difficult to persuade them to stop because there's a huge culture out there that promotes marijuana. So I had a guy that I admitted to hospital a couple times now. When I first met him a couple years ago, he was very psychotic and he was smoking his brains out of marijuana. He had a website that he was the webmaster. He established his website, and it was for the promotion of legalization of marijuana in this country. So you could imagine when I told him that when he went home that he couldn't smoke any marijuana, how likely it was that he wasn't going to smoke any marijuana. He just thought I was some old guy who was spouting all this stuff at him because I wanted him to behave himself and that there wasn't any truth in what I was saying. So, you know, now he's been in hospital two or three times. He's now dismantled his website and now he's not smoking marijuana and things are fine. But that was a two-year battle, I think. So I guess I'm digressing a little bit. Hallucinogenic drugs like phencyclidine or PCT, PCP, LSD clearly can cause psychotic reactions in people. Inhalants can. We don't see a lot of that. Not so much anymore in the hospital. You see people that are huffing and inhaling solvents and glue, but not gasoline, not as much as we used to. I think because it's better access to the people that used to see me 20 years ago that were huffing or sniffing diesel or gasoline had trouble finding more exciting stuff. And of course that stuff was very cheap and now everything else is more accessible. So we don't see as much of it. Hypnotics, sleeping pills, tranquilizers of various sorts can cause depression. They don't cause psychosis. Sedatives can cause depression. They don't cause psychosis. If you're addicted to a sedative such as morphine and you come off it, going through withdrawal, you could get psychotic. So that's another example of a medication that in a state of withdrawal can cause you to be psychotic, but not in a state of intoxication. So alcohol and sedatives will do that. People typically using stimulants will come in and perhaps be psychotic. More often than not, somebody using cocaine or crack who comes in being very psychotic, usually the next day or in a couple of days, usually they're fine. But then they go to bed and their withdrawal is kind of a combination of craving and having no energy because they're burnt out and you're taking away their stimulating substance, so they just want to sleep. And then a couple of days later they get out of bed and eat everything in the fridge and then they're fine and they just want to go home. If you have somebody come in who's using a whole bunch of alcohol or a whole bunch of morphine, and once that dribbles out of their system, they don't go to bed. Then they wake up and they can't sleep for weeks and they get really quite sick. So going cold turkey off alcohol or going cold turkey off narcotics is sometimes a life-threatening condition. Most people who come to emergency and say, I need to be admitted because I'm going to stop all my morphine, normally we don't admit them because it's not usually life-threatening. But if you're elderly or if you have a complicating medical condition or if the doctor just seems to have sympathy for you, we will admit you because of your comorbid medical illness or because you're frail or because we just realize how tough it can be. But there are doctors in this town who deal with chronic pain and prescribe narcotics all the time, and they basically say, if you want to come and see me and you want me to treat you with something different, then you need to get off your morphine and you need to go home and you're going to be sick for a week and then come back. So it's not considered life-threatening, but sometimes we get people at emergency that are pretty angry that we won't admit them because they know that they're going to get pretty sick. We also have psychotic illnesses that are sometimes caused by another medical condition. Again, it's prominent hallucinations or delusions, and you must simply have an illness that is capable of causing it. So most commonly this happens with endocrine or metabolic disorders, perhaps Cushing's disease. Sometimes massive thyroid problems can cause it. Autoimmune disorders like systemic lupus erythematosus can cause it. And epilepsy is an uncommon but sort of well-known illness. You have temporal lobe epilepsy and can cause lots of hallucinations. We don't see a lot of temporal lobe epilepsy that causes hallucinations, but it's well-known. So now I was going to talk about a little bit about medications. And I kind of thought I'd just do it a little differently than I usually do. So there's a lady by name of, I think her name is Andrea Cipriani. So in 2009, this lady went around the United States and took a look at all of the head-to-head trials comparing all of the antidepressants that had ever been done. And so she came out with this amazing paper in about 2010 that was the most meaningful paper we ever had, sort of actually comparing the pros and cons of antidepressants. And now she's partnered up with this person called Lucht, and I have no idea if that's a him or a her, and they've done a similar thing with antipsychotics. So they've looked at 212 trials. I'm not sure if they were done mostly in the United States. There may have been some in Europe or Canada. 40,000 patients, all in what they call randomized controlled trials. So these are considered the best sort of research that you can do. So they've taken quality research in multiple centers across at least the United States and probably more countries, and have taken a look at how do these drugs work, how do they compare. How do they compare for effectiveness? How do they compare for side effects? So I thought that maybe it might be a useful idea to show you what the drugs are that we use these days. I'm not going to talk very much at all about the drugs that we quit using 10 years ago. There's a bunch of old drugs out there that we occasionally still use that are fine to use if all else fails. They certainly have their place, but we're not going to talk about those tonight. We're going to talk about the newer drugs. So let's do that. So these are the drugs that we have available in Canada now. And these are all new drugs except for this one. This is an old drug. The rest are all new. So we have quite a few new drugs. So if you want to look at the, so in these, comparing these 212 research studies that were done very well, they found that the drugs that work the best to reduce the symptoms are at the top. And the drugs that work the worst to reduce the symptoms are at the bottom. So just quickly to run through them so you know what we're talking about here. Clozaril has always been known to be the gold standard drug. We've always known that that's the best drug that we have. It's a complicated drug, it has lots of side effects, but it's the best. If you want a drug that is by far most likely to reduce your symptoms more than any other drug, that's the drug you want. But then you have to decide if you want the side effects, because the side effects are significant. With Clozaril, and I'm not going to talk in this kind of depth about the other drugs, but the biggest problem with Clozaril, essentially all the drugs that we're talking about tonight and Clozaril can cause problems by reducing the amount of white blood cells that you have. They all can do that. Clozaril does it a lot more commonly than the other drugs, and it does it commonly enough that they won't allow us to prescribe Clozaril unless you have blood work done regularly, and they won't even dispense your prescription unless the pharmacist and the doctor and the drug company have reviewed your blood work for that week to make sure that's not affecting your white blood cells. So when you think about it, with that safety mechanism in place to make sure that you can't even get your pills if your white blood cells are dropping, I think it's a pretty safe drug. Because as soon as things start to go wrong, we spot it. But in addition to that, Clozaril has some other side effects that we'll talk about. But the concern about the white blood cells is relatively unique to Clozaril. So people probably are aware of most of these drugs. So olanzapine is used a lot. Its trade name, brand name is Zyprexa. Risperidone is a very popular drug, known as Risperidol. This is a relatively new drug that is actually the active metabolite of risperidone. So a few differences between risperidone and paliperidone, but not many, because this one is made from this one, so not a whole lot different. It's called Invega. Oh, haloperidol is also a very old drug. And that's misspelled, so there's two mistakes in the slide deck. So it's haloperidol or Haldol. It gets used here and there for things. It's quite effective. It's sort of intermediately tranquilizing. It gets used in ICU a lot for people that need to be safely tranquilized. It's not used a whole lot for treatment of psychotic illnesses, but occasionally. Quetiapine is a new drug. and it's known as Seroquel. Abilify is newer, known as aripiprazole. Abilify's claim to fame in Canada is that it's only recognized in its main, until recently it was only recognized in Canada as being useful in treating depression. So we don't use it by itself to treat depression. But if you're depressed and you're on an antidepressant and it's working pretty good and then it quits working, or it's working pretty good but not good enough, if you add Abilify to it, and half the people who have that situation, the Abilify will make your antidepressant work better. So in Canada, it's usually it's used mostly to treat depression. It's recognized as being an effective drug the way I described it. In the United States, it's used more for the treatment of schizophrenia. It's also recognized as being a mood stabilizer all by itself. So in the United States, it's used to treat manic depressive illness all by itself. It's used to treat depression all by itself. In Canada, we use it to help people with depression. And in the States, they use it as an anti-schizophrenic drug as well. It's kind of an interesting drug. We're getting more and more of these drugs that have multi-purposes. Ziprasidone is known as Zeldox. It was kind of one of the, when we became very concerned about weight gain with some of our newer drugs, Zeldox came along. You'll see in a minute that it doesn't cause much weight gain, if any, but it has other problems. And chlorpromazine is the old drug. Now we have a couple of really new drugs on the market. Sofras in Canada is indicated for the use of bipolar disorder, but we know in the States they use it to treat schizophrenia, so of course we use it up here for a bit of both. And Latuda or lurasidone are brand new. So these drugs have really been around for less than a year in Canada. Some of these drugs are available longer in other countries. So we've looked at, from best to worst, how do they work? And that's what we have here. If we look at from best to worst, what about weight gain? These drugs are the worst. So the clozaril, that was the most effective drug, is one of the worst for weight gain. In this study, it shows that olanzapine is a bit worse than clozaril. Really, the difference is very small. Chlorpromazine isn't used a whole lot, so it's not really relevant. And then you can see as you go up the scale that the ones that Haldol has some pretty serious side effects, so we rarely use it for the primary drug for treating schizophrenia. Ziprasidone has some other side effects and it's not always reliably effective. So, you're always trying to balance the side effects. So you don't want your people to gain weight. You want your people to be on a drug that will work. And you don't want them to get other side effects. So we have these things called extrapyramidal side effects that have been around for a long time. Before we came up with all these new drugs, extrapyramidal side effects were our concern. When I was 30 years old, this is what I worried about, because people didn't gain a whole lot of weight on the older drugs. We worried about people having extrapyramidal side effects, which included horrible feelings of restlessness, sometimes muscle stiffness, so people would get a very difficult spasm in their neck, and they would get a torticollis, and their neck would be twisted around, or just get sort of muscle rigidity, and they have trouble walking. So most of those things were fairly easily dealt with, but we used to worry a lot about the extrapyramidal side effects. So the new drugs, clozaril never causes extrapyramidal side effects. Haloperidol causes a lot. And you can see within the middle, there's quite a spread over which ones are bad for that and which ones not. So some of the really good drugs, here, clozaril, which is the most efficacious drug, the most effective drug we have, and olanzapine, which is probably the second most effective drug we have, causes very few, if any, extrapyramidal side effects, but they both cause a lot of weight gain. If they cause a lot of weight gain, then you're at risk for getting type 2 diabetes. Somewhere in there, you become at risk for hypertension, you become at risk for your lipids going out of whack, then you become at risk for having the metabolic syndrome. So we're energetically trying to avoid that these days, because you can't have people getting horribly sick from the side effects of your medications if you can help it. So it's a bit of a conundrum now, because the drugs that work the best cause the big problem. So, but it's also important to point out that I have people on clozaril that don't gain weight. I have people on olanzapine that don't gain weight. And I have a friend who runs the Carnot Center, which is the specialized unit for hospitalized schizophrenic people in Calgary at the Peter Lougheed Center. And he says that the clinicians that work with him and the huge majority of the patients that they deal with would much prefer to be on clozaril and olanzapine and put up the weight gain because they appreciate the quality of life that they get. The association that I work for, our college, tells me that if I can't justify using a drug that could cause somebody to have hypertension and could cause somebody to have diabetes, that I have to be able to justify those things before I pick those drugs. So, you know, different people that you listen to put more value on, does this drug work wonderfully well, or are you going to give your patient more problems? And in the end, it has to be up to the patient. But it's a very difficult and complex things to work through, because it's not just efficacy and weight gain, it's efficacy and extrapyramidal side effects and efficacy and other things. So prolactin is another one that we became concerned about a few years ago. Some of the drugs that are pretty popular these days, like risperidone and paliperidone, which is made from risperidone, these drugs elevate your prolactin levels significantly. So if you have a lot of prolactin floating around in your system, if there's any good news to that, sometimes the good news is young girls on this drug can't get pregnant. The bad news is, of course, that they're not fertile. The more common problem we run into is women are at greater risk for developing osteoporosis, because it's like essentially putting them into early menopause. People have trouble getting pregnant, men have trouble getting erections, they have all sorts of sexual problems. And then you have to ask your individual patient to make a determination for themselves about how important that is. So we have a bunch of drugs up here that don't cause these problems very much, but not all of them are the ones that work the best. So QTC prolongation is also something that we look at very carefully these days. This is a cardiac phenomenon where some of the drugs that we use delay the rate of electrical conduction in your heart to the point where there can be a big problem. So in your heart, you know, the way your heart works, the blood comes into your left atrium, then your left ventricle, then your left ventricle and out the other, then your right ventricle and out the other side. So it's important that they all contract sequentially, so that if it all contracted at once, the blood would just blow all over the place. So you have to have this smooth contracting function of your heart so that it pumps blood around your body efficiently. And if the electrical messages that go around your heart telling each little chamber of your heart when to contract become faulty, and the timing of your heart becomes asynchronous or isn't synchronized properly, your heart loses efficiency. And if it becomes extreme, your heart will just start fluttering and not doing anything effective at all. And there are extreme cases where people die from this. So we always want to know which drugs are likely to cause this and which ones are not. And these are not just psychiatric drugs. We're just talking psychiatry here. But some of the antidepressants can cause this problem. There are a lot of things like antihistamines that can cause this problem. Things like Gravol can cause this problem. Over-the-counter meds can cause this problem. So it becomes, as we get to know more and more, you know, my life was a lot easier when I didn't know all of this stuff, but I think my patients do better now, of course, that I can protect them from or help educate them. But it seems like we're making pretty complicated decisions now with our patients. So, sedation. Sometimes we want sedation, sometimes we don't. The most effective drug we have is markedly sedating. Some of the other drugs, like olanzapine, which is a very effective drug, is significantly sedating. Drugs that, say lurasidone, which doesn't do very well in terms of how likely is it effective. It's not a highly effective drug for most people, but it doesn't cause sedation. So, but then again, you have to remember that when I talk like this, although lurasidone doesn't have as good a track record, and that you can't consistently count on it to work as well for your patient as you can for olanzapine or clozaril, for some people it's a magic drug. So all of these drugs occasionally are magic for some people. So when we talk about, you know, looking at 40,000 patients on average, we're showing you which ones usually are the most effective, but there's always exceptions, you know. So I had a friend of mine, he used to be a resident of mine a number of years back, came up from where he works now in Claresholm and spoke to our group a couple of months ago, and he works in a chronic rehab psychiatric place down in Claresholm. And that's the kind of place where people go who have been tried on all sorts of drugs, nothing's been too impressive. So it's kind of go down there and see, go there for a whole year, let them take their time in getting to know you and see if they can't come up with some better answers. So he came up and told us all sorts of wonderful stories about lurasidone. So it's still true that on average it doesn't work well as frequently as the other ones, but sometimes it works very impressively. So that makes the decisions even more complicated also. So the other drugs that we use a lot of these days are the depot antipsychotics. So these are the drugs that are available in depot injectable preparation. These drugs we inject into somebody's muscle, and they generally last either 2 weeks or 4 weeks. Sometimes they last a bit less, sometimes a bit more. Haldol is available. It's an old drug. It's still available. Clopixol is an old drug. These first four are old drugs. So risperidone, which is a pretty popular drug, is available in a depot preparation that lasts 2 weeks. And it's called Consta. I said before that paliperidone is the active metabolite of risperidone, so it's effectively made from risperidone, is now available in an injectable form, which lasts a month. The most obvious advantage over the monthly injection to the every 2 week injection is simply that people would be much happier coming to get poked every month. There's small differences. I think people on paliperidone find that they gain, neither one of these drugs cause much weight gain on average, but paliperidone tends to cause less weight gain. Also, paliperidone seems to be slightly less sedating, although neither of these drugs are considered relatively sedating. And in the States, aripiprazole is available in a 1 month depot injection. It's now available in Canada. It's not covered by anybody. I got some the other day by asking special favors, and so you can get it if you have some really good reason to think that it's a magical drug for your patient. You can get it. They're going to give basically free drug to 300 patients in this country until it's covered, which they expect it'll be covered by Christmas. So and where we use these drugs, there's two things going on there. If you just think a little bit about what you know about drugs in general, it used to be that if you went and got a cold preparation because you were sneezing, it said take it 4 times a day. Now you can pick one up for your sneezing or your allergies just once a day. Because it's not just convenience, it's because once a day works better, because you have the blood level or the concentration of that drug in your system is steady all day. If you take 4 Gravol during the course of a day, you take a pill, you have good serum levels and it drops off, then you take another one. So the concentration of the drugs in your system that you're taking 4 times a day are like this. And not too surprising, it doesn't work as well as if they're like this. So if a one-day drug is better for you, then surely something that has a steady concentration for a whole month is even better. But really the reason that we use the long-acting depot drugs are for the people that are poorly compliant with their medication. So a lot of people are poorly compliant with the medication because they don't think they need it. Other people are poorly compliant because they think I've made a mistake and figured out the wrong dose, but they know they need some. Some people have cognitive impairment and just flat out forget. If I had to remember to take my pills 4 times a day, I'd probably forget also. They did this interesting little study in the States 5 or 6 years ago where they developed these little pill bottles that had a little computer chip on the top, and they sent people home with these computerized pill bottles. And then after a month, they could tell how often the patient had taken their pills. And they were looking at people with schizophrenia. And these were people that were really very ill with schizophrenia, people that were quite well with schizophrenia. But on average, there was a 40% of people with schizophrenia missed a significant number of their doses, and significant number was defined as 10%. So the compliance rate with people taking their medications isn't great for lots of different reasons. If you combine that with the very clear knowledge that when your 20-year-old patient comes into the hospital, you decided this fellow has schizophrenia, you know that telling a 20-year-old that you have an illness that could cause you lots of trouble, we don't know how it's going to go, your life might change, he's going to be really scared. Is he going to go home? And the likelihood of your 20-year-old patient is being informed about schizophrenia, or your 20-year-old patient about informed about diabetes, them going home and looking after themselves perfectly, is not all that great. Being 20 and being asked to accept a diagnosis like diabetes or schizophrenia, especially when they don't know a whole lot about it to start with, and this sounds like a scary illness, is a problem. So we know that compliance is a big problem for lots of reasons. We know that every time you have a bladder infection, and it comes back after you've had 10 of them, it's going to be really hard to fix it. If you have 10 admissions to hospital because you didn't take your pills and you have schizophrenia, it's going to be a whole lot harder to get you back on track than if you only had one. So we in Calgary and Edmonton and all the big cities, they have early psychosis clinics where they specifically have tons of extra money to treat young people. And what they do better than we do is they have all this money, they have all these programs, so the 20-year-old patient goes to the early psychosis program maybe 5 days a week, maybe 3 times a week. The family goes 2 or 3 times a week. The educational opportunities there are immense, and all the resources they have to help keep these kids on track does a great job. These kids are much more likely to take their pills because they're getting better educated. The families are getting better educated. The families can help. Their questions are answered. They meet all sorts of other people with this illness who are doing better, so they're more encouraged. And we don't have any of that. In most places, we don't have that. So I think, around here, personally, I think if you believe that the likelihood that your 20-year-old patient is not going to take his medications faithfully for the next few years, which is a really critical period in his life. For me, I think a depot medication is a really good option. So I use them for a lot of young people, even if they say to me, I'm going to try really hard and I understand that I'm sick, I still use them a lot. I think depots are great things. If you look in Canada, how often do we use depots across the country? I think the average is less than 15% of people with this illness are on a depot injection. If you look at the United Kingdom, it's greater than 50%. So for the two reasons. One is to ensure your patient does as well as he can do, and partly awareness of non-compliance and acknowledgement of this anosognosia where people don't know the real, so why in the heck would they take their medications? And awareness that the more often you end up in the hospital, the harder it's going to be to do a really good job for you. It doesn't mean we can't, but it's harder, right? So then, then we also have these community treatment orders. So, in Alberta, I think we're pretty fortunate that we have the ability to hospitalize patients against their will. We have all sorts of review panels that run around making sure that I'm not being reckless and doing that inappropriately. And we have things like community treatment orders, which is similar to being held in a hospital against your will. With a community treatment order, in theory, we can compel you to take your medications. So, I think some of those things sound like they're pretty heavy-handed, but, I think if you use them appropriately and you've forced hospitalization appropriately and depots appropriately, and certainly don't use them for people who don't want them and don't need them, that some of these things are helping us to do a much better job. The fellow I told you about earlier, who after 2.5 years, is now going to work with us and sees what's wrong with him. He wouldn't be here if it wasn't for he wouldn't be doing this if it wasn't for depot and community treatment order and forced treatment. So I don't want to sound like I'm putting in big plugs for forcing people to do anything, but you can see where it's awkward when it's a serious illness. Sometimes people don't get it. They don't take their pills for various reasons. And you need to really try hard to work with your patients to help them be compliant and do as well as they can. And it's an illness that's difficult to do that. We're short of psychiatrists, we're short of resources, and so we do the best we can. And I think sometimes the depot provide a pretty helpful solution for more than one reason.